Oh, you know what would have saved their marriage? Is violent sex. Right?
Dude, we're talking about a woman that wore Billy Bob Thornton's blood in a vial around her neck. I doubt there was anything but violent sex.
What? That happened?
Welcome to the What's Our Verdict podcast, where we fashion ourselves cinematic judge and jury. My name is JJ Crowder. I'm here with my co-host, Mattson Heiner.
Better red than dead.
Javier Ortiz.
What is up, my nerds?
And Ian Anderson.
Some shit.
Man, I don't know what to do with myself saying all three of your names again. Like, it's been so long.
Yeah, dude. That took forever. Holy shit.
Do you guys ever find yourself wondering if you should spend the time, money, or both on a movie? Well, we're here to answer that question for you. Each week, we put a movie on trial, discuss the facts, pass judgment, and let you know our verdict. We do appreciate any help growing the podcast. Hit that follow or subscribe button. Tell a friend about us. Go check out our website, whatsourverdict.com, and subscribe to our email list for exclusive content and updates. Also, if you listen on Apple Podcasts, Podchaser, Stitcher, please leave us a review. That helps us grow the podcast a ton. We'll read it out over the recording and give you kudos. We do appreciate feedback and reviews, so go ahead and do that. This is our arbitration series. We haven't done one in a while. So what that is, we compare two similar movies based on shared topics and decide which one did it better. In the courtroom today are the assassin action comedies Mr. and Mrs. Smith versus Killers. Mr. and Mrs. Smith was released on June 10th, 2005. It was written by Simon Kinberg and directed by Doug Liman. It starred Brad Pitt, Angelina Jolie, Vince Vaughn, Kerry Washington, and Adam Brody. It's about a bored married couple who's surprised to learn that they're both assassins working for competing agencies and now need to kill each other. Killers was released on June 4th, 2010. It was written by Bob DeRosa and Ted Griffin. It's directed by Robert Luketic. It stars Ashton Kutcher, Katherine Heigl, Tom Selleck, Catherine O'Hara, Rob Riggle, and Catherine Winnick. It's about a vacationing woman who meets her ideal man who happens to also be a CIA assassin. Back at home, their idyllic life is upset when they discover their neighbors are assassins contracted to kill them. The topics we'll be using to compare these movies are the couples, the supporting cast, the realization, the comedic relief, and the fight scenes. Man, I forgot how long that intro is for the...
You okay? You seem a little winded.
God, I'm fat, dude. I can't talk that much that long. Shit. If you guys haven't listened to us before, when we do these, we will rate both movies at the end based on a 0 to 5 scale. 0 being absolute garbage, 5 being a great, fantastic perfection. Never found a better movie, and then anywhere in between. But to get started on these movies, let's talk about it. Let's talk about the couples and compare these couples. I'm kind of biased, so I'm going to turn it over to you guys. What did you guys think of these couples? What are your comparisons? What do you guys think?
Unless you're biased for Brad Pitt and Angelina Jolie, I don't understand what the discussion is here. Because Brad Pitt and Angelina Jolie are like cool, right? Like I just kept thinking that. I'm like, wow, these two people are cool. To be fair, I watched it after I watched Killers, and they are not cool, right? Like Ashton Kutcher and Catherine Heigl, whatever her name is, Heigl. I'm like, wow, the first 30 minutes of watching Katherine Heigl on the film on the screen, I'm like, this is the most uncomfortable thing I've ever seen. So, yeah.
You guys know me from one of our previous arbitrations that I'm just not a huge Ashton Kutcher fan across the board. So,
no, you're not.
Definitely
Angelina Jolie and Brad Pitt, were they together during this movie?
No, this is the movie that broke up Brad Pitt and
I wasn't sure if they were together or started it.
Yeah, this is
you know what would have saved their marriage is violent sex. Right?
Dude, we're talking about a woman that wore Billy Bob Thornton's blood in a vial around her neck. I doubt there was anything but violent sex.
What? That happened?
Yeah, when she was married to Billy Bob Thornton, she used to wear a vial of his blood around her neck.
Why?
Has she been married?
Why the fuck not?
I mean,
once you reach that stage, you can do whatever you want. Do you have that money, much money and fame? You just do whatever you want.
I mean, to be fair, it doesn't take that much money to get blood out of you, Ian. So, like, I mean, I could walk around with a vial of your blood if, like, I really wanted to.
Just remember, I'm Aryan. The problem will be solved with a firearm.
Exactly. Audience is learning. Funny.
But I mean, to JGT or comparisons, I don't know if there's much to talk about here because Javier already said it. Like, there is the it couple, like the cool kids, like the popular couple in high school. That's what I thought Mr. and Mrs. Smith were. They just had that. And then you got like the little nerdy Ashton Kutcher that's like driving this really cool looking, I can't remember if it's a Ferrari or if it was a Romero or whatever it was. And then Katherine Heigl's character is just like a basket case. And so they already presented them as just like uncool. And like he was some super awesome spy. And yet, like, I don't know, they didn't set themselves up for success, where Brad Pitt and Angelina Jolie's characters, like they were both just super good looking, super suave, like in control mentally and physically. Clearly there's things going on in their lives, but you were like, yeah, like I want to be them. You did not want to be the other couple.
That's so true.
Yeah, it's crazy because I think about it too, and I'm like, look, Ashton Kutcher, and especially in this movie, like he was fit. Like I was watching going, yeah, dude, he's ripped.
What?
Like he's chiseled and shit. And I'm like, I mean, these are not unattractive human beings, but God, were they doofuses. And I'm like watching this going, why would anyone find this endearing? Like, I don't believe these two together because I think they'd end up like driving off a cliff on accident because there's just that weird, like,
I will say that when Ashton Kutcher's character was like unraveling, I'm like, okay, this is funny, right? Like Kristen Heigl, hey, how do you pronounce
Catherine
it again?
Heigl,
jeez, what a stupid ass.
Wanna be Charlize Theron for sure.
Like, her quirkiness was just weird. I'm like, it just did feel like a fit. And like Ashton Kutcher, to be fair, was like pretty suave and cool like most of the movie until like he gets discovered and like his wife is like pregnant and he's just like flipping out in this grocery store. Right. Like that scene, I was like, that was actually pretty funny.
I agree with you. Like, I think he had his moments where I actually liked him more than I thought I was going to. And I was surprised. I saw this movie 11 years ago, whenever the hell it came out. But I was like, I didn't remember it. That's one notch knock against it, but I just didn't remember anything about it other than that had assassins in it. Like, to the point that Ian texts me while he's watching it, and he's like, we probably should have done like Night and Day with this movie instead of Mr. and Mrs. Smith.
So good.
And wow. I was like, he's right, because I hadn't watched it yet. And then he's like, yeah, we should have done that one. I'm like, really? And then because I for some reason thought Katherine Heigl was an assassin too at some point, like, or became one. I mean, thank God she didn't, but Jesus, like, it was rough. And I can't stand her. So, like, she feels fake in everything she does to me. Like, her acting is so forced.
Okay, I don't mean for this to be rude, but what's wrong with her teeth? Like, she has too many teeth, or they're like too, like, what? Like, she has like a Joker smile, and she smiled is like kind of went like up her face.
I guess that never bothered me. I didn't think about that.
Yeah,
I didn't think about that.
You're a terrible person, Javier.
I guess so.
I mean, I'm okay with it. That's funny. Rude.
Like, hey, you look like the Joker.
You got fucked up teeth. I'm not trying to be rude.
I wouldn't say that to someone's face, but I just couldn't think of a better way to bring that topic JJ's up.
Tagging her.
No, I'm not. I don't want to hang out with her, talk to her. I don't enjoy anything she does.
What else is she in?
As a dude, she made a bunch. So she was, I guess, she got famous being in Grey's Anatomy. That's the one. Yeah. So she was in Grey's Anatomy. Yeah, it's one of the 10,000 doctor shows, but she was on Grey's Anatomy, I guess. And then she did a whole shit ton of movies, like with big people. Like, she did this one with Ashton Kutcher. She did one with Gerard Butler. She did, there was a couple, yeah, she's been like
the 27 dresses or something.
What was it? 27 dresses.
Oh, no, I've seen that.
Yeah, okay. She's done a bunch of movies. None of them are good. But she did a bunch.
What's funny is, like, I feel like I really like Ashton Kutcher, but I can't think of anything he's good in except that 70s show.
So. I like him in The Guardian.
Yeah.
In The Guardian. Coast Guard.
He's also really good in Steve Jobs, the one where he played Steve Jobs.
He is also good in that.
Oh, very good.
Butterfly Effect. He's not Ashton Kutcher. Like, he definitely went in full blown. I mean, to his credit, like, you'd have to remember that he was Ashton Kutcher in that because he totally was not himself or what you would expect him on screen.
The wacky part about him is he's known for comedy, but the things that I've liked him in have been dramatic movies. Like, he doesn't play a comedic role. Like, Javier, you mentioned Butterfly Effect. Like, I loved him in that movie. And that's the movies I think of. They were very dramatic and serious roles, not these comedic things. But everybody thinks of him from that 70s show. And so
it's because he peaked. He peaked at that 70s show.
Fair enough.
He was really good in that show.
Yeah.
I'm gonna give him credit.
He only has one style comedic character he can be.
Oh, for sure. He did one, though, that I thought, one thing that I just thought of, and then we'll move on because we've been talking about Ashton Kutcher and Katherine Heigl for far too fucking long at this point. But he did do a movie called Guess Who back in the day, and it was pretty funny. I actually enjoyed it. Now, he wasn't the funniest part, but he was pretty funny. Bernie Mac, rest in peace, man. That guy's funny as hell, and he was in it. But it was an old it's a new remake of Guess Who's Coming to Dinner, and it was pretty funny. It was well played, and he was pretty good in that one. But Bernie Mac stole that movie.
You're going to be Mr. and Mrs. Smith.
Yeah, Mr. and Mrs. Smith was amazing.
I'm not going to drive back the Mercedes. Like, I'm not going to get a different car, but
I'd drive that. House.
When was this filmed?
2005.
Oh, I just felt they were way too rich and cool to be driving the cars that they were driving.
I thought he was driving a caddy.
Yeah, he was driving like a caddy CTSV. It's a pretty fast car.
Yeah. Both of those cars were bitching.
Wasn't she driving like a Subaru Outback or wagon or something?
Yeah. It was a Mercedes. It was a Mercedes, but yeah.
That was a Mercedes MOK with a hatch. That was, and back in 2005 was the first time they did the hatch. But yeah, that's a V8. That's like a 450 horsepower car.
Somebody
gets to the grocery store.
That car's bitching. I'd drive it in a heartbeat. But I like hatchbacks. I like utility. You ever gone to Costco and they give you those big fucking boxes full of groceries? Because why the fuck would we have bags like every other grocery store on the planet? But they give you the big boxes. That's the worst shit, trying to get that in my trunk and play Tetris in my trunk. Casey's little hatchback, fucking A, man. I just set that some bitch on the flat back. Works out real good.
Costco's allowing you to use your brain, JJ. Saving the environment as well.
Yeah, well.
Unless plastic bag is a good thing.
That's fair. I use paper bags most of the time anyway. All right, so let's talk about the supporting cast then.
Vince Vaughn.
Vince Vaughn.
Yeah, let's move on.
Well, it made me laugh because we did that movie. What was
Mom,
it?
I almost shot you.
Yeah.
Mom, I almost shot you.
Well, we did.
We're on high alert.
Yeah. You don't even know. Well, Vince Vaughn, so we just did Freaky, and I looked at Casey when I was watching it. I was like, see, this is the Vince Vaughn I needed in Freaky. Like, this is the guy. Because the whole movie, man, he's just hilarious. Whole movie. Yeah,
he killed his role.
That scene near the end where he's like, man, it's good to see you alive. Did you kill that lying bitch? Yeah. And Angelina Jolie is like, this lying bitch? He's like, I mean, it's good. That whole diner scene with him is hilarious.
It's like, if you're Macy, she's Gimbals.
I've been in his life a long time. I don't need those looks from you. And he's like, focus, Eddie, focus.
He's standing there. The dude's got the furnace and Brad Pitt's picking through all the pieces. He's like, you're killing me with this, the tongs and the furnace. And he's just pacing the room with the shotgun.
The only person worth talking about in my opinion, in Killers is Catherine O'Hara. Like, she was only funny supporting character in that whole movie. And she's standing next to Tom Selleck the whole time.
I did laugh my ass off when she pours, like, was it tequila? I think it was tequila or wine or something. And she's pouring it in this big goblet. And there's, like, a little bit left. And she just looks at it and is like, fuck it. And pours the rest in and starts drinking.
What is that thing that she's concocting to, like, nurse her hangover? Is that what you're talking about?
Yeah, she drunk the night before, and then the next day
it's that was
the
morning. Grey Goose vodka she was pouring.
Was it Grey Goose? Yeah, I just know she's pouring this whole bottle in what looked like a fucking flower vase. Like, it was like,
ironically enough, I shouldn't even know what Grey Goose is, but I watch enough sports that they have enough commercials for it that I recognize the bottle.
Grey Goose is delicious.
Or at the end of the movie where she's pouring wine and Katherine Hagel's like, okay, zone of truth. And she's like, she pours more in as soon as she hears that.
What is the comedian, though, that tries to kill him, though? It's his, like, boss or whatever.
Rob Riggle.
Like the part
Love Rob Riggle.
When they're going through, like, all the things Ashton Kutcher did for him as, like, a good friend and everything. Like, he's like,
barks a lot.
Like, his dog died and something with his balls and everything that they went through. I was like, man, like, it's pretty deep. Like, that's a lot.
But we were friends. He's like, really? You just didn't seem that invested. He's like, what? He took that so personally.
Yeah, that's what I was going to say. I was like, I can't forget Rob Riggle. I mean, look, he's no Vince Vaughn, but he's funny.
I did a good job. I liked him. He made me laugh.
It's funny for the movie he was in. If he was in Mr. and Mrs. Smith, I would probably like him a lot less.
Well, yeah, I mean, again, you're setting him next to one of the all-time greats. But I liked him. He also makes, every time I see him, like, I think of other movies that I love him in, like Larry Crown. He's the guy that fires him, and he's like, he's like, he's got the ring, like his school ring from
college. Three semesters at some fucking.
Yeah, and then he delivers the pizza at the end to him, and he's like, "You're a good man, Larry Crown."
He's in New Girl for like an episode where he's Schmidt's older brother.
Yep. Yeah, he's in so much stuff. Oh yeah, supporting cast. But I also liked in Mr. and Mrs. Smith, like I liked their like, so you had Vince Vaughn, but the girls were kind of funny to watch too. Like, especially because she like abused them emotionally, like constantly, like the way she was. She's like, girls, go make coffee.
And dude, then she makes them cook boss for her. Bitch, bro. But,
makes him cook for her whole fucking life, like.
Oh yeah.
Never.
And they had the audacity to talk back to her with the elevator scene. He's like, "Well, you said bye."
Yeah, I enjoyed that dynamic too. All right, so let's talk about the realization, Javier. You wanted to talk about, so like the moment when either the spouse or the each other in Mr. and Mrs. Smith realized that they were assassins.
Yeah, I don't know. Like, I like Mr. and Mrs. Smith because in the beginning they make you think like they're having affairs, right? Yeah. So it's like, oh, wow, like this big reveal. And in Killers, you just know Ashton Kutcher is an assassin the whole time, right? Yeah. So in Mr. and Mrs. Smith, even though I've seen it before, like you're kind of revealed at the same time as they are. Mm-hmm. Whereas in Killers, you just know the whole time you're just waiting for this to blow up in their face, right? Like if I had to choose a realization, I would like Mr. and Mrs. Smith first because I feel like I'm part of the story as opposed to just like third party watching it. That's just one reason, I think.
I got to be honest. Neither of them really were that great to me, especially, I mean, the Killers was really weak. If you think about the dad, I guess he was supposed to kill, that was a good agent, but then the guy that told him to do that thing turned out to be bad. And yet for years, you're living this life and the dad, you're the dad knowing this and you let this guy marry your daughter. And then all of a sudden you're like, nope, it seems like he's going back. I saw that postcard. Like I got to bring out the sleepers and go kill him now. Like that's weird. And then to me, I don't know, Mr. Smith, like maybe I've just seen it too many times. It just doesn't have as lasting appeal for me because I knew that they were assassins and I kind of saw that coming and it didn't carry as much weight with me. So it hasn't been as timeless. And I guess that's not as much of a knock as maybe it should be if you were seeing it for the first time, but neither of them are great for me. It wasn't like a big, like, oh my gosh, like a huge twist or
anything. Dude, that dinner scene in Mr. and Mrs. Smith is awesome. It's just like, you could cut the tension with a knife.
But good point. Like for the first time I saw that probably exactly, but I don't know. It just didn't hold up for me later on, but a valid point, Javier.
Yeah, I get a kick out and I can see that, like, because obviously, you know, and I think I was talking about this with Casey, actually. I was like, that's one of the things about Mr. and Mrs. Smith that I like so much is the fact that, because I've seen this movie, it's low key one of my like sleeper favorite movies. Like it's like
your guilty pleasure.
Yeah, it is. It's like one of my guilty pleasures. And I think the reason for that is because for me, even though I do know the outcome, like I know exactly what's going to happen, like I still giggle, like as he's figuring it out and she starts to get an inkling because of the way that he shakes his leg when he pisses, and like you if you pay attention when he's peeing in the bathroom and she's getting ready, you see him do it, but then you don't notice, but she still hasn't made the connection until he drops the wine bottle to get her to catch it. Like that whole, like you said already, like that whole scene when they're really kind of feeling each other out, he knows for sure because he found her office, she thinks it might be him but she just can't believe it.
They're pulling knives out of nowhere. Yeah, seriously.
Well, he's like moving her aside so he can cut the hand, the roast beef or whatever. He throws the martini in the plant and she eats the olives.
The Drano.
Yeah. And then he's afraid to eat. He has to eat the roast beef, but he's afraid to eat it because he sees like the poisonous shit in the mirror later on, like the skull and crossbones. Like that whole thing like makes me laugh every fucking time. Well, and then how it's like this play of just silliness after the fact. And okay, so that, with the realization, I think Mr. and Mrs. Smith obviously wins because I'm with you. My problem with Killers with their realization is the only thing funny about it is she comes back in the middle of the Rob Riggle fight and he's like, just get me this. And I'm here, give me a knife or whatever it is. He sends her upstairs to get a knife for him or a gun. Or gun.
He's like, there's a Glock. She's like, a Glot? What's a Glot? That
did make me laugh. Shoot him in the face.
I was like, the face is like, you're gonna shoot yourself.
Yeah, that's Thought that was interesting coming from a very seasoned assassin.
Yeah, that's a 45, man. That's going to go through that dude's head.
Yeah. That's going to hurt. And that's if she can even... The kickback on that thing, she'd end up shooting him in the face. So, yeah, that one, the reveal wasn't... I mean, it had its funny moments, but it wasn't as, like, well-played and cleverly thought out as the other. But the comedic relief, this is one where it's an interesting conversation because Killers is, like, in-your-face comedy from start to finish. Like... Mm-hmm. The awkwardness, the over the top shit, like they're trying really hard to be funny. And at moments, they do really well with it. With Mr. and Mrs. Smith, it's like a lot of times it's subtle humor. Mm-hmm. And I think I found myself laughing a little harder more often with Mr. and Mrs. Smith. But you guys tell me, what do you think?
I will always laugh at the scene where Brad Pitt is like running around his house, like checking the windows and running through bushes while his neighbor's walking by. Hey, John, your car's kind of hanging out of the driveway here. Yeah, thanks, Bill. That will always make me laugh.
Or he gets his neighbor to go into his house first because his wife is there to kill him.
That's one of my favorite parts. When he turns him around the corner with his collar of his shirt. Red oak, Bill. Red oak.
One of my favorite parts of that movie is when he's running through the yards and he falls on the fence and accidentally pulls the trigger. And you see Angelina Jolie's face and she just... rage, and he's like, no, it was an accident, stop. And then she hits him with a car.
I do love that part about that movie, but half the time they're trying to kill each other, it's over an accidental bullet through the window. Or when he's like, she drops, like when the elevator drops and he thinks it was her, and he comes to the restaurant after that where he proposed to her and she's having dinner, and he like pours her the champagne, and he's like, I was trying to think of what to say when I got here, just needed to drop in, huh? Or some shit like
giving me the shaft.
Yeah, the subtle humor is great. Yeah,
it's hard to think in the Killers like moments that really were truly funny. I mean, obviously there's a part when she comes back and that guy's in the chair and they're like talking about them being friends, like we said earlier on, but I don't think there's a lot of comedic moments that necessarily stick out to me. So I think Mr. and Mrs. Smith for me wins.
I think the funniest part of Killers is when he pulls the gun out of the car seat and he's like, hold this. And she just has it in the palm of both her hands as he's like drifting a car and she's screaming. She like has no idea how to hold a gun.
I just love that he keeps going back to the seat, like spread your legs. And then he cuts a hole, gets the gun. Then he's like, they get back in later and he's like, spread them. And she's like, how much do you have in there?
How can you not tell?
Yes.
Right? Like, how do you know? Are you sitting in this seat and you can't feel a full size 45 Glock under the seat?
Laying horizontally, not vertically, Javier. I don't know.
Oh, God. You got a full size hand cannon cut into the vinyl and you can't feel it.
I don't understand how I got away with that.
Why the fuck is his seat so hard? Oh, and who knows how many rounds he's got? He pulls out a shit ton of bullets, too.
You will be happy to know that when he was loading the mag, those were 45 rounds. So,
well, that's cool. Yeah. Well, I didn't see any like reload issues in either of these movies.
Yeah, I find myself like counting shots, and Brad Pitt almost every time reloaded before he was out, which seems like a good, you know, habit as an assassin to have, because I do that in Call of Duty, so it just makes sense.
Speaking of that, I really thought it was interesting watching the two different styles of killing in Mr. and Mrs. Smith. Mm-hmm. Like they're very, very different in how they go about the job, especially at the start when she's got like all these stealthy mines set up with lasers and he just drives a doom buggy in with a rocket launcher. With
donuts. He pulls a rocket launcher out.
The music's blaring and shit.
Yeah, I love that.
But I love when he shoots the rocket. So he gets shot by Angelina Jolie because she doesn't know who he is. He gets up and fires the rocket in her little hut. In the end, he looks at it and he's like, you should not be able to buy these.
This is random, but the part when he goes back to the house to see if his gun stash is there and it's like cleared out.
Oh.
And he's like, bitch. And then he goes back and he does the shuffle and he punches the air like six times.
Yeah.
Seriously, one of my favorites. I laugh just as hard now watching that as I did 16 years ago, the first time I ever watched this movie.
I've been that frustrated before. Not at my wife, right? But like so frustrated, it's either do that or scream.
Yeah.
Like,
I love that it starts before he even gets to the basement part of the shed, right? Like he opens the door and he's like, oh, oh. because he knows what's coming. And he opens it and he's down there standing on the stairs and he's just like, you see this like emotion going through his face. He's like, bitch.
Though Angelina Jolie has got to be the worst recon assassin ever, because that thing was just like a trap door in a tool shed with like a little like lock on it, and she just never, it was never curious enough to like go in there.
Guess not. Yeah, that was some funny shit.
They respected each other's space, because that's something they showed. Like, they never seemed to want to try and pry too much in the other's kind of life when they were like going to the bathroom, when she was changing out of that seductive suit she was wearing. And so I feel like maybe she just never really went in there that much, and that was part of their lives, because they were trying to be together yet also be very separate. So I always thought that, I mean, that was one of their biggest relationship problems.
Well, speaking of that seductive suit, that's why I don't trust dominant women, because they just break your neck. That's actually advice my dad gave me when I was a kid.
That's funny. Well, I mean, funny enough, you were a kid when this movie came out, so
I'm just kidding. My dad never spoke to me.
Well, there you go.
Why did everyone get sad?
That was that's depressing. Weird advice when you're like 12 years old.
But not inaccurate.
Wait, when did you said 2005?
Yeah.
Was that 15 years ago?
Yeah.
Did I do that math right?
Yeah, 15 Jeez. Years ago.
2005 was 15 years ago. 16, I guess, now, it depending on when it came out.
16 years ago. Came out in June of 2005.
Oh my gosh. What?
That's silly, isn't it?
That is stupid. How old was I 15 years ago?
I don't know.
I was 13.
Dude, you can go fuck yourself.
Do it yourself, you coward.
I will. Oh, I was 24. I was 24 when this movie came out.
24?
Mm-hmm.
Dude, you were almost my age right now.
I know. That was 16 years ago, fucker. Dude, I turned 40 in a month.
40?
In a month, I guess, month and a half.
Now I'm friends with a 40-year-old.
Is your birthday, JJ?
March 31st.
Dude.
Yep. Another funny part, and probably my favorite part of this entire movie, Mr. and Mrs. Smith anyway, is the fight scene, like when they come home, not the fight scene, what is it? Oh, what am I trying, like when they're in the van and they're driving, they're running away from the assassins, like that whole scene, like where they're being honest with each other and shit. And he's like, honey, I need to, and they're just calm as fuck when they're talking to each other. And he's like, honey, I need to be honest. I was married once before. And like, she slams on the brakes. He goes, and she's slapping his leg while they're hitting Chase. And he's like, what? Stop. She goes, and then she asks, what's her name and social security number? No, you're not going to kill her.
No, you're not going to kill her.
And he calls her like, it's not like you're a beacon of honesty. She's just like, yeah, my mom and dad, they died when I was a kid. I'm an orphan. Web of lies.
Who gave you away at our wedding? But she was like, you're always the first to break rank. You know, like that time you forgot a present for my mom's birthday. You're fake, mom.
That whole scene in the van is probably my favorite part of that whole movie. Like, I love it. Even at the end, like when everybody's dead, and then he's sitting in the front, he gets up in the front seat and he turns the radio off, and he's like, we're going to have to redo every conversation we've ever had. I'm Jewish.
Oh, yeah. I'm Jewish.
So funny. All right, let's talk about the fight scenes. And I'll kind of change that topic. Let's call it the action scenes, the action sequences, because I don't know. Not all of them were fight scenes. We just talked about that car chase scene, which was pretty cool. But I think there were, across the board, the one thing about Killers that I will give it, as funny as it was trying to be and over the top, man, the kill scenes, some of them were crazy brutal.
Oh, the car one, like in the construction zone?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, where he flips the truck over with Rob Riggle in it. And then the other one with Catherine Winnick, where he like shoots the new antler chandelier and it comes down and like impales her all through the side. Yo, she's just swinging above the table. Yeah, it was crazy. Yeah,
Killers was pretty entertaining overall for like the kind of the action scenes. I didn't really mind it.
Dude, it was the choppiest shit ever watching Ashton Kutcher fight. Like the first fight scene he's in with Robert Riggle, it's like cut, 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 cut. I'm like, holy crap. Like we've taken four steps and we just cut like six times. What are we doing? It took like four cuts for him to fall through the little fall off the stairs. That really bothered me. Like it really, really bothered me. That.
But you're a John Wick purist, so I can see why.
I think John Wick ruins stuff like that for me, man.
I think it ruined a lot of stuff for a lot of people when it comes to that. Because you're not wrong. Like I noticed that too. Now I think about it and I go, okay, Am I really supposed to expect a former underwear model and Fat Rob Riggle to be great at fight sequencing? Probably not. But at the same time, it is jarring to watch the jump cuts to make it look like an entertaining scene. And they do that throughout this movie because nobody in this movie has strong fight choreography skills. Let's just go ahead and throw that out there.
No, in their defense, when Keanu Reeves speaks, it's a bunch of jump cuts.
It's hurtful, but it's fair.
But yeah, the newer action movies kind of made it hard for some of these older action sequences because they did a lot of that
things. Watching Ashton Kutcher hold a gun was painful for me.
True.
Like,
true.
He was like hyperextending his elbow holding this. Also, no one can shoot anything. They've got stormtrooper aim in this movie. Nobody shoots anyone except Tom Selleck. He's the only one who's got any semblance of aim.
That seems right, like how it should be in this movie. You know what I mean? If anybody's shooting somebody, it's going to be Tom Selleck. Quigley Down Under, man.
Dude, I love that movie.
From a mile off, you know?
I love Quigley Down Under.
And Mr. and Mrs. Smith, though, for how much they're shooting, like, I feel like one of them probably would have died. Like, for real. You're going to that much ammo and that much firefight and that much power. Like,
she had a shotgun at some point, dude.
I know.
Like, she's blowing walls in half. Like,
and like when he pulls out the gas line and she starts firing in there, I'm like, yeah. Like,
he was in there. Did I miss something? He was in that kitchen when it blew up.
No, he went around to the living room. He snuck around the backside. Because that's where the fight went. Because after that, the fist fight started, like the hand-to-hand fight.
He came out of the kitchen on fire. His clothes were on fire.
Did he? I thought he was in the living room. That's on me then.
So I'm assuming their goal was to not shoot each other, but they were real close to shooting each other. So that's where I'm like, I'm pretty sure one of them probably would have shot the other person.
Probably at some point.
It was just sexual tension.
Exactly. I will say that I do love the fist fight. And that's the one like where they interjected some really great comedy. Like,
come to daddy.
Yeah. Who's your daddy now?
She freaking clocks him over the head with a pot. Who's your daddy now?
And she smashes his face with two vases right between, like, just smashes both sides. And I love when they roll over the couch.
He's kicking her.
He's on top of him. They flip over the couch. She's on top, just socking him in the face. And then he flips her over and starts kicking her in the ribs. And then she gets a quick foot. Junk. And then, yeah, you see his junk kick.
And he falls. He just like collapses.
What a great fight scene.
I love that. That shit was great.
Get that marital angst out, ladies and gentlemen.
What I do appreciate, though, is that they didn't have sex and all their problems are solved. Right. They're like still bitching at each other later in the movie. So I'm like, I can appreciate that, you know?
Well, yeah. And they're constantly at each other. Like when they're laying in the sewer talking about their escape plans or whatever. And she says something about going to hers and whatnot. And at the end of the conversation, like he says something like fucking saying this shit. And she's like elbowing him shit. Like they're just constantly fighting, which I'm like, that shit's real. Like,
hey, ask me the sex question.
Forgot about that. Oh shit, that shit was funny. Yeah, I think it was an overwhelming choice on this one, but I will say that for me the closest that Killers came is the fight scenes, because of the fact that even though it's jump cuts and it's rough, just the brutality of the kills for a PG-13 movie, I was like, wow.
I also like that you didn't know who was next. Right.
True.
So just like those nerdy ass neighbors, like they're walking through with like MP5s and like whatever they've got,
full tack
vest. Yeah. And I'm like, I still can't take these people seriously. Like, I still think that they're super weird.
Well, and I love when her best friend, like Katherine Heigl's best friend, comes in and she's like, if any one of those two kill him before I do, I'm going to fucking kill all of you or some shit like that. It goes just like, oh my God.
I spent 3 years listening to you drone on. And she's like offended. She's like, oh, no, that makes sense.
Yeah.
I told you she's not a good person. You said that? That's rude.
That was funny. Yeah, there's some decent parts. And Tom Selleck, man, what a mustache.
Yeah, he had a shitty plan though. I'm going circling back to Mattson's comment of just what?
Yeah.
You had I don't even know. Cause at the end they're like, what? Like, my husband's a hitman and my dad is, I'm like, a domestic terrorist at this point, because he's straight up almost blown up an entire neighborhood. Like, there's multiple people dead because of him. Like, and then we just like hugged and like went on. I'm like, your dad's insane, bro. Like,
My problem is with these movies, do either of these movies believe in the cops? Like, your house blows up, there's multiple massive amounts of gunfire, not one police person shows up. They just don't exist. It just doesn't happen.
If anything, they would have shown up, shot someone like a minority, and then left, right? At the very least.
But that bothers me about both of these movies. Like, that is very just extremely unrealistic. Your house blows up, no one's showing up, like nothing's happening. You're having a gunfight on like a major highway and nothing's like, that does bother me. It, Javier, with the like counting bullets and such. I'm like, come on. Like,
I mean, they did show up once. So Mr.
Why are you attacking me? Why do all your comments have to like be directed at me like that? I don't come on here.
How you like measure how many like shots they take from a, like how many rounds they shoot.
Oh, comparatively, that's your thing. Yeah. Oh, okay, got it. I thought you were criticizing me like you can't bold, but you don't care about cops type of thing.
No.
Okay, I take that back. Sorry, I guess I'm just sensitive.
Technically, wait, they did show up.
I don't remember.
Mr. and Mrs. Smith, when they, after their fucking battle in the house and they have sex and like the neighbors knock on the door, there's two cops behind them, The two neighbors. And he's like, hey, Bob. He's like, dude, sorry about your red oak. And as the door shuts. But yeah, he says, hey, Bob. See you later, Bob. See you, officers. And the officer, there's two cops standing behind those two.
Okay.
But I mean, the house is pretty much about to fall down around them. And the cops are like, oh, it's all good. You said you're good and we'll let you go.
It's a nice neighborhood, Mattson. That's why the cops don't show up. They're like, they're probably fine.
More than half of your neighbors are assassins, so they all aren't calling the cops.
Yeah,
that's a good point.
That is a good point. All right, so based on those five topics that we talked about, for me, I give all of them to Mr. and Mrs. Smith, but I don't think that was a shock. What do you guys say?
Agreed.
Yeah, agreed.
All right. So Mr. and Mrs. Smith wins the arbitration between itself and Killers. Let's go ahead and rate these movies. Javier, we haven't seen you in a minute. Why don't you give us a start?
Okay. So I'm going to agree with JJ as far as having Mr. and Mrs. Smith be kind of like my guilty pleasure. Don't hate on me. I'm going to give this a 4. I forgot how much I enjoyed this movie. I laughed a bunch. I was really I had fun with the action stuff. Anyway, that was really good. Killers, I'm going to give it like a 1.5. Like, it is just an atrocious movie. I can't think of one thing that like I would go back and watch that for. I guess if you're going on like I'm watching every movie Ashton Kutcher's ever been in, then that's on your list. But yeah, I would not recommend watching this movie. Nah, I just have nothing else to say about that. Yeah, so I'm done.
And if you're looking to do like some sort of big watch a bunch of Ashton Kutcher movies, man, call me. I got so many better actors to choose for you. So yeah,
there's a number of actors you should do that with before Ashton Kutcher. Yeah,
exactly.
Unless you're just going alphabetically of every actor that's ever existed. There's still some A's that I think you probably want to hit up first.
Or if you got someone strapped to a chair, like with their eyelids taped open. Yeah, that's the list. All right. Ian, why don't you go?
I'm in the same boat as y'all. Definitely Mr. and Mrs. Smith. I forgot that Vince Vaughn was in this, and it was just like a present to be able to watch this and realize that he was in this movie and he was entertaining. But I'm going to go with Mr. and Mrs. Smith, like a 3.5. I think solid, fun, enjoyable movie. It kind of is what it is. Like, I'm never going to be like this amazing thing with a plot about two assassins that marry each other and then destroy them. Everybody that comes after him. And then Killers, I actually had a couple of parts that I thought were like goofy, quirky, funny, like especially the fight at the beginning where he like swipes at him with a knife and he's like, dude, what are you doing? I'm killing you, bro. There's just stuff like that made me laugh.
I thought about that line.
So I'll say a 2 on the Killers.
Yeah, I've already said it. Like I said, Mr. and Mrs. Smith's a very sleeper, one of my guilty pleasures. It goes right along with A Knight's Tale. Javier and I seem to agree on all of our sleeper guilty pleasure movies so far. So I like that. But yeah, it's at the core, it's not a great movie, ladies and gentlemen. It's not going to win any awards, but in my heart, it wins a very fun award because it's just entertaining. I'd never fail to have a good time watching that movie. I'm going to go right with Javier. He inspired me. I was going to give it a 3.5, but I'm going to jump to a 4 just because
guilty pleasure. Baby.
Guilty pleasure score, baby. And then on the flip side, Killers was the only movie I could think of that compared decently to Mr. and Mrs. Smith. And it was really just an excuse to watch Mr. and Mrs. Smith. And I did not enjoy this movie. I will say that I laughed more than I thought I would based on the fact that I didn't remember much about this movie, even getting the facts wrong about it, thinking they were both assassins at some point during that movie. So I won't shit on it too much, but it was forced. It's a little rough. Where Mr. and Mrs. Smith flowed well for me, and it's funny, Killers felt like they were trying really, really hard. And they succeeded at moments, but the other, when they're not succeeding, they are utterly failing, in my opinion. So I'll be nicer than I thought. I'll give it a 2 as well, just because it's still much better than some of the other movies we've watched. There's my 2. I will watch Mr. and Mrs. Smith again. In fact, I've been jonesing to watch it since I watched it a couple days ago. I will watch it again. I won't watch Killers ever again.
We can watch it together.
There you go.
For me, 3.5 for Mr. and Mrs. Smith. I'll give Killers a 2. I think, especially Mr. and Mrs. Smith, I've seen this movie before with one of my brother-in-laws, Eric, who is one of those people that's just always good to watch a movie with, probably like a JJ, where they're ready to laugh at some really funny moments. So I will say, if I had watched this movie with Eric or someone else or other people, Mr. and Mrs. Smith is good with a crowd of people for sure. It'll definitely get the laughs going, has some star power, definitely has some great one-liners. Vince Vaughn makes this movie for me. I think his character is just perfect. The Killers, I mean, if you want to see some beautiful people on screen, they exist. I think it's just more of a nerdy assassin movie that has some gimmicks, but isn't something that's really great. But I'm giving it a 2 because we have seen some movies that I would much rather not see over The Killers. Absolutely. So I'll watch Mr. and Mrs. Smith again. I'm sure that'll happen. The Killers, probably won't ever watch it again. That's okay. But a fun comparison this time.
Sweet.
Ooh. Uh-oh. I forgot my favorite line, which is when he gets back from the poker game and he's like, oh, I went down and, you know, played some poker or whatever. And she's like, how'd you do? And he's like, I got lucky.
It's a good one.
Yeah.
Funny fact, that room where they played poker was the same room, same set piece that they used to film Ocean's 11. Yeah. With Brad Pitt teaching the superstars to play poker.
Oh, no way.
Yep. Nice. Same set piece. They set it up exactly the same as an inside gag.
Oh, so, that's clever.
Yeah, good stuff. All right, that was a lot of fun.
All right, fuck off, everyone.
Yeah. Next week, we're back to our serious notes, though. So next week, we will be reviewing Judas and the Black Messiah.
When that Whoa. One comes out. What is that about? That sounds fascinating.
That one is actually based on a true story. A Black Panther.
Jesus was black.
Yeah. It's inspired by true events where a leader of the Black Panthers is betrayed by a member of the Black Panthers and is assassinated, possibly by the FBI. So looks like a very good movie. I'm excited to watch it. That will be coming out next Monday, which if you're listening to this on the 8th when we release, it'll be released on the 15th of February.
Does the FBI do anything except put those warnings not to copy DVDs and shoot political leaders? Like, is there anything else that they do? We should put that as a poll on our social media, or like a if anyone knows type of thing.
Yeah, not that I'm aware of. And on that note, Mattson, why don't you tell them where else they can find us?
Hey, you can find us wherever good podcasts are found at whatsoververdict.com. You can check us out, see what's upcoming. You can find us on Instagram, Facebook. Check us out on YouTube. See our new video that we posted of Javier watching a scary movie. Please do. You will laugh.
Wait, that got posted? I thought that was just posted for us.
I sent you the YouTube link, dude. That's for real.
Austerity.
I wasn't like privately posted.
No, dude, that's out there for everybody to watch.
Okay.
Anyway, thanks, Mattson, I think. So make sure you tune in. We appreciate you guys listening. It's been a great time, and we'll catch you on the next one.
Bye. Bye-bye now.
Cinemagic out.